and well-educated parent is required for a pavlik harness treatment. Certain complications of wearing the pavlik harness because of hyperflexion. Sometimes what will happen is that the femoral nerve palsy will occur because the nerve gets compressed between the thigh and the abdomen. If it is flexed too much, it can also lead to inferior dislocation of hip. If there is an inadequate flexion, the purpose of putting pavlik harness will be failing because it will fail to reduce the hip. Sometimes when we apply the shoulder straps tightly, it can also lead on to a brachial plexus palsy. Knee subluxation is also being documented as a complication of pavlik harness. And along the groin area and the popliteal area, sometimes there can be skin breakdown. The reported incidence of avascular necrosis in pavlik harness is 0 to 15%. The pavlik harness fails in two conditions. One is if there is an absent Ortolani sign, we should not wear a pavlik harness. That will definitely fail. And in case of a bilateral disease, you can't wear a pavlik harness. So this is a small flow chart regarding the pavlik harness. So first we wear the pavlik harness for the infant and we check the infant at 3 weeks. You do an ultrasonogram to see whether the hip is reduced or it is dislocated. The hip is reduced, you see whether it is stable or unstable. If it is stable, at 6 weeks, you can again repeat an ultrasonogram to check whether this hip is still reduced. And you can do a clinical examination to rule out the subluxation. You can do a clinical examination. If it is negative and the ultrasonogram shows a reduced hip, you can discontinue harness after 6 weeks. Then you can evaluate the child at 3 to 4 months. The X-ray, you can take an anteroposterior AP radiograph for the child to assess the position of the physis, whether it is present within the quadrants. And in 1 year, you can take a standing X-ray, weight-bearing X-ray. And after that, you can just follow it up every year or 2 years once up till the skeletal maturity is reached. Say if the hip is reduced, but it is unstable. So what will happen if it is unstable? What we have to do is at 3 weeks, if it is reduced but unstable, you should shift on to an abduction arthrosis rather than keeping the child in a pavlik harness so that it will be rigid. And at 3 weeks, if it remains dislocated, so what we need to do is after wearing a pavlik harness, if it remains dislocated at 3 weeks of ultrasonogram, we have to go for an arthrography. We have to find the reason for dislocation, why it is dislocated. Any hindrance is there. By arthrography, we have to see whether any secondary barriers are there, which is preventing from the head from sitting inside the acetabulum. Then you can either go for a close reduction or you can, if close reduction is not coming, then you can open the joint and you can reduce it. Then you can put the child in a harness for 3 to 6 weeks. And the rest is same as the stable criteria. As after 6 weeks, again, you can examine by an ultrasonogram or clinical examination. If the hip is still reduced, you can discontinue the harness. And repeat, then check the X-rays after 3 months, 1 year, and every year you can follow it up. Child with from 1 to 6 months of age, pavlik harness will be the first choice of treatment. It should hold the hip in more than 90 degrees of flexion so that the position of upper femoral metaphysis will be pointing towards the triradiate cartilage. In these childs, every week we have to examine whether the hip is reduced, both clinically and ultrasonography you should take to see whether the reduction is adequate. And if the reduction is adequate, the harness can be continued for 6 weeks. And few physicians, they recommend abduction arthrosis to be put after 6 weeks rather than going for a pavlik harness. They will prefer abduction arthrosis. Some older children, they require harness to be put for a long time so that it ensures an adequate acetabular coverage being developed. And after discontinuing the harness, we'll take an AP radiograph to check the reduction. In this image, we can see There is this is an image of the patient and after treatment with the harness. You can see after 1 month there is a notch developed at the just above the lateral margin of the acetabulum. This notch signifies that there is ossification occurring beneath the labrum, and it indicates an early successful treatment of DDH. So this is just an example of a 5 months old child where there is a left hip dislocated. This child is put on a Pavlik harness. First, subsequent image is showing inadequate flexion. Then after 2 weeks, they have checked it. Since there is an inadequate reduction, they are still increasing the flexion and bringing the metaphysis just abutting so that the proximal femoral metaphysis just it abuts the triradiate cartilage. They are bringing to that position. And then you can see the next image, 1 month later, it is in very good position, the reduced position. In 5 years, the femoral head is well accommodated within the acetabulum. The other orthoses which can be used are Ilfeld or Craig splint or a Von Rosen splint. There is also another orthosis called as Frejka splint, which is not being used because it has high chances of avian, so it is not being used. But these splints are also used, such as Craig splint and Von Rosen splint. Child from 6 months to 2 years, the goal is to obtain reduction of the hip without damaging the femoral head. Usually these childs present with a dislocated hip at the first presentation itself, they will be presenting with a dislocated hip, or previously the child would have been treated for a DDH and the Pavlik harness treatment would have failed. Those childs will be presenting from 6 months to 2 years. So what we need to do is we need to give a traction. Either we need to go for a closed reduction or an open reduction. For 6 months to 2 years, usually a closed reduction will be successful. So this is the traction. Traction is being given to reduce the incidence of avascular necrosis to enable the surgeon to obtain a better closed reduction. This picture here, it shows a traditional pre-reduction traction technique where the hip is placed in 20 to 30 degree of flexion. Gage and Winter, in their article, they described, they recommended traction until the head was below the Hilgen drainus line. So usually the traction is given for appropriately 2 to 3 weeks. Gage and Winter, they recommended this, the traction should continue until the head was below the Hilgen drainus line. This is another method of traction called as Bryant's traction, where the hip is flexed to 90 degree and knee is extended. The author prescribes this method, Takjian, he prescribes this method, that is portable home traction. It is made up of PVC pipe. It is a preferable method. The child can be even transported easily along with the home traction, either in a wagon wheel or it can even in the patient's lap, he can be held. The hip is in 90 degree of flexion, maintained in a skin traction. That traction is given for 2 to 3 weeks. So once the traction is given, the surgeon attempts for a close reduction under general anesthesia or sedation. The hip is being reduced by placing it in flexion of more than 90 degrees. As you can see the image, the hip is flexed to 90 degrees. Femoral head relocates into the acetabulum. If the flexion is reduced, in the image it shows 50 degrees where hip is flexed to 50 degrees and femoral head dislocates. So more than 90 degree will be required to reduce the hip by closed reduction method. So we have to give a flexion of 90 degree, gradually abducting it, gently lifting the trochanter, just like doing an Ortolani's test. You have to reduce the femoral head within the acetabulum. Only a minimal force should be applied. We should not force it. If you force it, then it may lead on to avascular necrosis. Palpable reduction is always the key here. It is always felt. The reduction is always felt here rather than it is heard. The range of movement, it is checked. We are checking the point of redislocation either by adducting. Once you adduct, you check the point of redislocation. It is noted. You are extending the hip and seeing. You are checking the point of redislocation. That is noted. If the internal rotation is required to maintain the reduction, that is also noted. Just a minute, sir. Okay. Ramsey and Associates, in their paper, they told that they described safe zones for hip for maintaining the reduction. They calculated the range of motion, as I said before, the point of dislocation while adducting, the point of dislocation while extending, and if internal rotation is required, that is also noted. So the range of motion in which the hip remains reduced is compared with the maximum range of motion. With this, a safe zone is constructed. This first example is a wide zone of safety, where the range of the safe zone is abduction of 30 to 65 degrees is described as the safe zone. So less than 30 degrees, the point of redislocation starts. So further, if you adduct, it dislocates. And beyond the 65 degree, the chances of AVN is getting increased. So you can see the 80 degree to 90 degree, definitely there are high chance of AVN. So the zone of safety, here it is maximum from 30 to 65 degree. When you see this, there is a moderate zone of safety, as the range is between 35 to 60 degree. And the last picture, it shows a narrow zone of safety where it is only between 40 to 55 degree. Only in this zone, the hip remains located. Within 40 degree, less than 40 degree, if you go, it starts dislocating, and you can't even keep more than 55 degree where there are chance of AVN. So arthrogram is definitely required during the closed reduction to check the depth and the stability of the reduction. It is a live observation. We are having a C-arm. We can check the die. We can check whether the obstacles which are present within the acetabulum is hindering the femoral lead from entering it or not. Based on that, we in the AP view, it has been reduction has been classified into three types, as good, fair, and poor. The width of the medial dipole is measured. In good reduction, there will be a narrow rim of contrast material. Femoral head will be well seated and it will be stable. If it is 5 to 6 mm of width of the medial dipole, then it is called as a fair reduction. If it is more than 6 mm, so there is a wide joints seen there. Wide zone of contrast will be there. So more than 6 mm die, it will be indicating as a poor reduction. And certain obstacles which are encountered during the closed reduction, it is being mentioned in this picture. That is the one is indicating the capsule which is being constricted by the iliopsoas. Two will be the infolding of labrum, which hinders between the femoral head and the acetabulum, acetabular cartilage. And third will be ligamentum teres. Ligamentum teres also acts, it occupies the depth of the acetabulum, it prevents the reduction. So this is another example of a one-year girl with left DDH, an arthrography being done during a closed reduction, where there was a 5 mm wide dipole indicating a fair reduction. Hip was internally rotated for the femoral head to seat better within the acetabulum, and it is abutting the triradiate cartilage. And the other images where the reduced hip well seated within the concentric acetabulum is shown. So once the reduction is achieved, patient should be put in a spica cast. The child should be put in a spica cast after close reduction. If the closed reduction is stable, the child is immobilized in a spica cast in stable and safe position. The safe position is the human position, which is nothing but a flexion of more than 90 degree, abduction of 30 to 40 degree, internal rotation of 10 to 15 degree. We need to check the position of the femoral head in the CR. Then we have to proceed for cast application. Even after cast application, we can confirm whether the femoral head is within the acetabulum by taking a single section CT or an ultrasonography. Also, regarding the vascularity of it, we can take a perfusion MRI. This image which is given below is a MRI, is an image of the perfusion MRI, wherein this D, you can see the vascularity of head is decreased, and once the cast is removed and again it is properly reduced, you can see the vascularity has increased and it turns, the head appears bright after perfusion. This is an image depicting the method of applying the spike cast after reducing and holding in the human position of flexion 90 degrees, more than 90 degrees, abduction 30 to 40 degrees, and internal rotation of 10 to 15 degrees. Spica cast is applied. First, you can have the cloth over the abdomen for breathing, and then the vibril is placed from the abdomen to the thighs in a figure of eight fashion. Usually, after closed reduction, below knee spica cast is applied. You can also you should also have a window for the toileting purpose. Once the cast is applied, after 6 weeks, the cast is removed under anesthesia. The stability is checked. We should not attempt to dislocate the hip. Just a range of movement is assessed. Don't try to dislocate the hip. An AP radiograph will show you how the femoral head is seated within the quadrants. Then, if the hip remains reduced, the spica cast is applied again. This will be your second spica cast in the human position. In this situation, if there is any doubt about reduction, if you feel that the reduction is not proper after 6 weeks, then you can again go for arthrography to check whether any obstacles are there. And then if obstacles are there, you can just do it by closed reduction. Or if you are not satisfied with that, you can go for an open reduction. So if the hip remains reduced even after 6 weeks, then you can go for a second spica cast. And after 6 weeks of second spica cast being put, you can remove the second spica cast. You can further examine again. And if it is stable, you can go for a third spica cast. So totally, we are putting three spica cast. This is given in TACGN. The literature is exactly from TACGN. So every 6 weeks, we are checking. If the reduction is stable, you need to repeat the cast. A total of three casts is applied. So we'll move on to the open reduction. So the open reduction, if we are not able to stabilize the hip by closed reduction, in the first attempt itself or after.
Manoj,
sir,
can we have a discussion about the initial management before going to open reduction?
Sure, because it is
a long talk.
Sure, sir.
Any doubts and any questions? Through Pavlik cornus management, no?
Yes, sir.
So another thing is, no, ultrasound, the Barlow's positive hips, we don't treat with Pavlik cornus. So Barlow's positive hips, most of the Barlow's positive hips, 80% of the Barlow's positive hips stabilizes by 2 months. So Barlow's positive hips, we have to observe. Suppose you do ultrasound again after 6 weeks, if it is still you have a subluxatable hip, then probably we'll put a Pavlik cornus.
Okay, sir.
So that is one point I want to note. So straight away, we don't put the Barlow positive hips into the Pavlik cornus. But ortholani positive, definitely, of course, because it is a dislocated hip, which is reducible with the clunk. So that we put in a Pavlik cornus as early as possible immediately. And another things, everything you told. So you do that. When the child is in Pavlik cornus, every 2 weeks, you have to repeat the ultrasound. Every 2 weeks, you have to repeat the ultrasound. Either thing is, you can reduce the hip and fix the Pavlik cornus. Suppose if the hip is not reducible, you can put the Pavlik cornus. The Pavlik cornus itself will helps in reduction.
Okay, sir.
Because it is a dynamic orthosis. It's called dynamic flexion abduction orthosis. That is why the movements of the muscles is very important. Arthrogyposis, that there is no muscle movements. Again, post-septic dislocation, there is no active movements. So all neurological problems, there is no active quadriceps movements. So we need a quadriceps. Abductors and flexors should act and the quadriceps should act. So that is why it's called a dynamic flexion abduction orthosis. So it is indicated only in a developmental dysplasia. It is not indicated in a teratological or contractures conditions like AMC or post-septic hips. So every week we do the clinical examination. Make sure two things: to look for a skin changes, any pressure source or the popliteal fossa, some skin ulcerations in the groin, other things. So number two, check whether the child is actively extending the knee, quadriceps function. So you have to educate the child, educate the parents also regarding the active extension of the knee. so that if the child is not extending the knee, then probably the femoral palsy is there. So that is important point clinically what we see. Then ultrasound every 2 weeks, make sure the hip is inside. Then end of 6 weeks, we remove the pelvic harness and do the ultrasound, do the Barlow's test. If it's stable, then we can wean the pelvic harness for the next 6 weeks. Slowly we reduce the time in the daytime. We converted nighttime pelvic harness, and end of 12 weeks, we continue remove the pelvic harness once for all. Then follow up with the, as you told, follow up with the periodic X-rays till the acetabulum is normal. Suppose the child is well reduced, the acetabulum is by 2-year-old X-ray, the acetabulum is absolutely normal, then probably we can observe maybe once in a year, once in 2 years. If the acetabulum development is inadequate, then probably we have to follow the child frequently every 6 months. That is one point I want to mention. And
So initially, how long so 24 hours the pelvic harness, the baby should wear it for 24 hours?
Yes, 24 hours.
24 hours.
They should not remove the pelvic harness.
Okay.
The parents are educated only, they can loosen the chest strap to clean.
Okay.
They should not touch the foot stirrup, they should not touch the abduction strap and flexion straps, they should not touch.
Okay. And so with the pelvic harness?
With the pelvic harness, they can midline on the chest strap now, which is like at the level of the nipple.
Nipple, yes.
And they can loosen this, they can clean, and they can restrap it again. So we normally mark with the marker so that how tightly they have to fasten the straps, so that they will not do the over tightening to compress the chest.
Okay.
So every time, make sure every time the child is extending the knee. Don't flex more than 110 degree. No, don't flex more than 120 degree. Hip flexion, the femoral palsy is common.
Okay.
Again, the posterior strap, the abduction strap, tightening the, fastening the abduction strap, you try to adduct both the thighs. The adduction should, both thighs should be able to come to the midline. It means you correctly fasten the abduction strap. If you are not able to bring both thighs to the midline, then probably the abduction is more forceful. You have to loosen the strap.
So how often do you do it neonates? Because your child is there. So how often you are using, how you are able to diagnose a neonate with a DDH? So is it very common, or because we never see them, to be honest.
Honestly, for you, pelvic harness indication to our treatment children's patina on the very, very rare. Most of the children they come delayed after 6 months, after 1 year.
Okay.
Neonates,
I don't think they don't really find out. Yeah, dislocated.
Yes, exactly. The screening program is very undiagnosed. So the screening program is very, very important, Clinical screening. Yeah. The ultrasound screening is not reliable in the initial at birth. The high risk of suspicion, the high risk individual, the clinical screening. Then if the clinical screening is of doubt, then you have to do ultrasound. Because ultrasound screening at birth, it is a lot of false positive. Because it operator dependent. Sometimes ultrasound positive hip, it stabilizes by 4 weeks or 6 weeks. And if you put all the ultrasound positive hip in pelvic harness, then probably we are over-treating.
Okay.
That is why, if it is ortholanis positive, completely dislocated hip, you can put it in a pelvic harness. Otherwise, if it is subluxatable hip or subluxated hip, you wait, you do the repeat ultrasound at 6 weeks, many of the hips stabilize spontaneously.
Okay.
Many of the hips stabilize spontaneously, then no need to treatment, just observe. Just observe for a established dysplasia. So in that we can avoid over-treating the children.
No, so it might settle down. That is the point. Barlow's test. So the pediatrician should know it better, or the orthopedician should, it's not going to come to you. Only if it's going to come to you, you're going to do. So how many pediatricians can pick out the ortholanian Barlow's test?
No. Some of the pediatricians, some of the neonatal specialists, they are able to pick up. They are able to pick up. Especially now, most of the times, if there is a breech presentation, if there is a family history of DDH, definitely they will we are getting referrals from the pediatrician to roll out.
Okay.
So in that case, we are examining. Another thing is, when you are examining, make sure the child is placed on a hard surface. Child is calm and comfortable. Don't examine in the child where the child when the child is on the pillow. Don't examine the child when the child is on the mother's lap. It is misleading. Oh.
Okay.
Put the child over the hard surface. Then gently examine. When the child is crying, then definitely you will know you won't get. So ask the mother to free the child. Make sure the child is sleeping. You should be very, very gentle. No force.
Okay.
That is very, very important. When the child is crying, if you examine, sometimes we will miss a diagnosis.
Okay. And yesterday we had a small discussion about till what age is Ramprasadan cater, till what age is Otto Lanni and Barlow's test significantly positive? Because till what age we can take it as positive? There is 3 months to 6 months or 6 months to 9 months.
Only 1 month, first month, newborn period only, at least in the first month. Second month, third month also it will be negative. Very difficult.
It will be negative only.
So probably so at the maximum, at the maximum maybe 3 months. So that is why the pavlik harness treatment is indicated only for the first 3 months. When child started turning, the pavlik harness is not useful.
Oh, okay.
Once the child
has to be started before.
Yes, when the child started turning, the pavlik harness is not useful.
Okay. We just came to our conclusion that is maybe up to 3 months.
No. It depends upon suppose with the child is laxity, you will get a reduction even at 6 months, 8 months also, you will get the Otto Lanni positive.
Okay.
Even at 6 months, child sometimes will get a close reduction, Otto Lanni will be positive.
Okay.
But sometimes it is not a true positive, maybe a false positive.
Okay, so up to 1 month we can take it as
small. Yeah, yes, you know, it might definitely, be definitely. Yeah.
Okay. Even up to 3 to 6 months, only on rare conditions it will be possible. Okay.
Up to 3 months maximum.
Okay. Thank you. Ramprasad, ninga edha kekkanuma?
Aama Suresh, kekkuda thiru kekkuda.
Ah, kekku solunga boss. Barlow's positive children, nearly 50 to 60% of the Barlow's positive hips stabilizes by first month. 80% of the Barlow's positive hips stabilizes by 8 weeks.
Okay, so bilateral hip la vandu power legs harness poda mudiyada?
Nari failures, bilateral hip is very difficult to control. You have to go for a close reduction casting. You can wait for at least 3 months, you do a close. You can try a pavlik harness, but a lot of failures. It's not a contraindication, but the success is very, very, very less. You can try, but it's not a contraindication. But the contraindication is teratological, irreducible hips. So that is why, you know, even the pavlik harness can be used to reduce the hip under the guidance. So if the hip is not reducing, you put the pavlik harness, you do ultrasound every week. By third week, if the hip, even after the 3 weeks of pavlik harness, if hip is dislocated, you have to remove the pavlik harness, go for some other treatment. Otherwise, you will end up in a pavlik harness disease. What Manoj told, no. Because persistently dislocated femoral head, posteriorly dislocated head, we will press on the acetabulum and it produces permanent changes in the acetabulum as well as the femoral head. It's called pavlik harness disease. Because we are flexing the hip more than 120 degrees, it produces a lot of pressure over the acetabulum as well as for the femoral head. Then it causes permanent changes, a lot of bony changes. So 2 to 3 weeks, every week you have to do ultrasound, make sure the hip is reducing. Even after the second or third ultrasound, the hip is dislocated, you have to abandon the procedure. Go for a next procedure is a closed reduction, arthrogram and spica.
I think fairly it's, I think we've understood the utility of Otto Lanni test and I think pavlik harness. So when it can be used and how long it can be used and what is the intermediate time that at which the screening should be, as the ultrasound should be used to find out whether the Pavlik harness is really working or not.
Yes,
so definitely. When to, you know, when to continue and when to discontinue the Pavlik harness, I think that is the critical point in the utilization of, I mean, the utility of Pavlik harness. I think that is the message that I think Suresh Babu wants to convey. Correct? Then, eh?
Yeah, ultrasound should be done without removing the Pavlik harness. Very important. Now, don't remove the, let the sonologist remove. Sometimes, you know, they will remove everything and do the Pavlik harness ultrasound.
Okay.
Even in so you have to tell them don't remove the Pavlik harness and do the ultrasound without removing the Pavlik harness.
Okay.
Then end of the 6 weeks, once it is stable, reduced, end of 6 weeks you can take up the Pavlik harness and check the ultrasound. And you do the stress examination at the time. Okay. I mean, Barlow's maneuver, make sure the hip is stable. Mm. Then, weaning phase for another 6 weeks. Okay. Gradually, we can take off in the daytime and convert it to nighttime bracing. Then, you can take off for the age of 12 weeks. Okay. Roughly 6 to 12 weeks after the hip stabilizes.
Okay.
6 weeks for the stabilization period, 6 weeks for the weaning. Totally 12 weeks of Pavlik harness.
Okay. I think Manoj, you can continue, Manoj, I think.
Okay, sir. So, thank you, sir. Suresh, sir. Thank you.
Regarding spica, I want to mention one more point. You mentioned the spica for every 6 weeks, you have to change the spica. And very important, you have to change the spica under anesthesia, under GA. Don't change the spica in the outpatient department. So after anesthesia only, you have to remove the spica. Very important. So, when you are removing spica again, you remove the front off first. Cut into two offs, remove the front off first, then surgeon should hold the limb in a reduced position. That is whatever the position, the 90 degree flexion, 45 degree abduction. Then lift the child and remove the posterior half. Then position the child over the spica table, then clean it. When you are cleaning everything, one person has to constantly hold the hip reduction. Very, very important because hip spica needs more manpower than the surgery. So when you are changing the spica, you are likely to miss the, again, the hip may redislocate again. So holding is very, very important. So my advice is no, when you are holding, no, you hold it in a more extreme abduction. When you are putting a spica, you are putting cotton and bandage, you don't hold it in a exact position. You hold it in a more than 60 degree of abduction or 70 degree of abduction. Once spikes, everything is set, then you put the POP roll. When the POP is setting, you gradually reduce abduction to desired abduction. So I always used to tell my PGs to hold it in a more abduction. When the spica is setting, so don't use a warm water, always use a cold water because we need a lot of time for the molding everything. So then gradually you reduce abduction. When the spica is setting, you gradually reduces and keep it in a 45 degree of abduction, 90 degree of flexion. That is a human position. Rotation is very, very minimal. Don't rotate too much because when you internally rotate in a closed reduction, it will tighten up the iliopsoas and constrict the medial circumflex vessel that causes AVN. Because the medial circumflex vessels goes around the iliopsoas muscle. So when you internally rotate more, it will tighten up the muscles which is an obstacle for the reduction. It will sometimes press the medial circumflex femoral artery that can cause AVN. Again, extreme abduction produces more joint pressure, there's a lot of avascular necrosis is more common. That is another point. Another point in the when you're putting a POP, always put the POP posterior to the trochanter, you have to mold it. Many times, no, we concentrate more on the anterior aspect. Forget about the plaster in the posterior aspect. The posterior plaster is very, very important. So the molding posterior to the trochanter and don't allow any dead space between the plaster and the gluteal region and the trochanter. So you have to mold it nicely around the trochanter and posterior to the trochanter so that the hip will not slip in the postoperative period. The molding is very, very important. Sometimes, you know, we do everything is reduced. If you do a post-op CT cut, it will be posteriorly subluxated. That is why the CT is very important. The X-ray is misleading. If you take a post-op X-ray, the X-ray will show the hip is pointing towards the triglyceride cartilage. Van Rosen's line will be correct. But the hip is subluxated posteriorly. It will be seen only in the CT cut or MRI cut. So normally we ask MRI cuts, single cut MRI. இன் நியூபார்ன் சில்ட்ரன்ஸ் ஆர் லெஸ் தன் 6 இயர்ஸ் 6 மந்த்ஸ். ஓல்டர் சில்ட்ரன்ஸ் வி ஆஸ்க் ஃபார் எ சிங்கிள் சிடி ஆக்சியல் கட். ஸோ தட் வில் ஷோ வெதர் த ஹெட் இஸ் சப்லக்சேட்டிங் போஸ்டீரியலி ஆர் நாட். ஸோ தட் இஸ் வை தட் மோல்டிங் அரவுண்ட் த ட்ரகோயிண்டர் அண்ட் போஸ்டீரியர் பார்ட் ஆஃப் த ட்ரகோயிண்ட் இஸ் வெரி வெரி இம்பார்ட்டன்ட். These are some practical points we learned it during the procedures.
Yeah, understood. Very practical, very important points. In a posterior, it is dislocating, so you have to give the support posteriorly and forget to concentrate anteriorly. Anteriorly, there is no issues at all. In fact, you can keep it light.
Yeah, yes. We do understand. Anteriorly, we can keep it light.
Yeah, we can keep it light. Yeah. So, I think the practical points. That's another thing. I think we wanted you. So, shall Manoj continue or you want
to? Yes, Manoj.
Manoj, continue.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. So, next we'll move on to open reduction. Just a minute, sir. So, we'll move on to the open reduction. Open reduction is done when there is a failure to obtain a stable hip by closed reduction method. As sir said, within the cast, we are not able to maintain the hip reduced. It redislocates when we are taking a single section CT or an MRI. When we are checking in that the head is not adequately covered by the acetabulum, then we need to go for an open reduction. And if there is a failure during cast changing, when we, as he said, as Suresh Babu sir told while doing the cast change, he exactly mentioned the posterior cast has to be maintained and anterior cast has to be removed. So during those procedures, if the position is missed, then again, you can go for an open reduction if closed reduction is not possible. And in unstable hip, where you have an excessively wide joint, As mentioned before, the medial width of the dipole is more than 6 mm, then you can go for open reduction. There are two approaches being described for open reduction, medial approach and then anterior approach, anterior and anterolateral approach. Medial approach first. Medial approach is usually preferred for a child less than 1 year, preferred by most surgeons, since it has minimal dissection and the obstruction is directly encountered. So this is the procedure. The child lies supine over the table with the hip flexed and abducted. You can just palpate the adductor longus. The incision is just you put a transverse incision parallel to the groin, centered over the anterior border of the adductor longus. Then you can dissect, and when you dissect, you can see the adductor longus, which is detached. Further, you can have an interval between pectineus muscle and the femoral sheath. There are two approaches. One is you can go either anterior and lateral to the pectineus muscle, or you can go medial to the pectineus muscle. So these are the two approaches we can go. In this, we have to remember, as I said, regarding the medial circumflex femoral artery, it will just lie above the iliopsoas tendon, and we should be very careful avoiding injury to the medial circumflex femoral artery. So once the pectineus is retracted, you will have the iliopsoas muscle where you are going to dissect it. You are going to cut the muscle tendon junction, and the muscle is, as you can see in the right diagram, the muscle is being erased from the capsule of the hip joint. Once the muscle is erased, you can have the clear picture of the capsule where the capsule is being incised along the axis of the femoral neck. The picture shows. The incision over the femoral neck along the axis of the femoral neck. Either you can incise in this way or you can have a transverse cut making this as a cruciate incision and opening the joint. Once the joint is opened, you can see the obstructing structures such as ligamentum teres or the tal, which if required can be removed, and then the hip joint is reduced. And after reduction, once if you find whether the hip is not ossified under C-arm, if you check, you're not able to see the head, then you can have a fine wire rolled into a disc shape placed over the femoral head and X-ray is taken. There are certain variations given in the medial approach where after dissecting and transecting the adductor longus and iliopsoas, without opening the joint also, you can attempt a closed reduction. You can check for the intraoperative arthrogram. If the reduction is satisfactory, there is no impedance for the reduction, then you can conclude the procedure there itself without opening the joint. Or if it is not possible, then you can open the joint. So the disadvantage in the medial approach is that there is a narrow exposure. And as I said before, the medial circumflex femoral artery is the main thing which gets encountered during the procedure. If that is injured, then it will definitely lead on to avascular necrosis of the femoral head. And you also can't perform a capsulorraphy or capsuloplasty during this medial approach. So once the reduction is achieved, a below knee spica cast in human position is applied. And it is checked under the C-arm for the reduction. Also, if required, a limited single section CT and a perfusion MRI, like which was said previously for the closed reduction, same, you can take a single section CT or a perfusion MRI to check the reduction and the vascularity of the head. And again, after 6 weeks, you change the cast. The second cast is applied with the reduction maintained. And if the reduction is stable, a second cast is applied. And after applying the second cast, 6 weeks followed by the second cast, again you remove, you check for the stability, you apply a abduction splint, and that will be the orthosis, final orthosis to be applied in a medial approach. Since the iliopsoas is being transected, we need not worry. The text says that there is no functional deficit occurring after iliopsoas lengthening. Then we'll move on to the anterior approach. Anterior approach, it has a better exposure compared to the medial approach, and capsulorraphy, which is not possible in a medial approach, can be performed in an anterior approach. The indication is child more than 1 year, we go for an anterior. It's an anterior or an anterolateral approach. Some places they tell it as anterior, some places they tell it as an anterolateral approach. It is done for child more than 1 year old. The incision, which is shown here, it is a bikini incision. We call this as a bikini incision. This incision is done like you mark a line from the iliac crest to the greater trochanter. You divide this into 2/3 and 1/3. The junction of the 2/3 and 1/3, that is the starting point for the incision. It should travel along the anterior inferior iliac spine, and 2 to 3 centimeters beyond that, it should extend. That will be the bikini incision, anterior incision. It has an excellent cosmesis. Disadvantage, in case of some high dislocations where the false acetabulum has been formed, it will just mislead us. Since it is a false acetabulum, we may mistake it as a true acetabulum, and we'll reduce it. So this is the exposure. Once the incision is made, you'll have the deep dissection. You can see the tensor fascia lata muscle and sartorius muscle. An interval is created between the tensor fascia lata and the sartorius. And beneath this, you will have the rectus femoris muscle. During this approach, you should be very careful about the lateral femoral cutaneous nerve. Or an injury to this lateral femoral cutaneous nerve will cause neuralgia parasthetica, that we all know. You should be very careful. Once you create an interval between tensor fascia lata and sartorius, you make a deep incision over the cartilaginous iliac apophysis, and you start elevating the tensor fascia lata along with the iliac apophysis using a periosteal elevator, so that the tensor fascia lata muscle is pushed laterally and the sartorius is on the medial side. Now we can have a clear idea of rectus femoris muscle, where it is getting inserted over the origin over the anterior inferior iliac spine. Divide the sartorius and the rectus femoris. When you divide, you will have a clear view of the capsule of the hip joint. and mostly the lateral aspect of the capsule of the hip joint will be visible, and medially it will be covered by the iliopsoas muscle. So this iliopsoas muscle, either it can be actually it is not transected. Iliopsoas muscle is just lengthened to have an adequate exposure on the medial aspect of the capsule. And also, if you flex the hip joint, still the iliopsoas is retracted medially, and you have a still better clear picture of the medial side of the capsule. Once the capsule is exposed, we incise the capsule 5 millimeter from the acetabular margin. The incision starts just at the level of the greater trochanter, and it will end at the level of the transverse acetabular ligament. This is one incision which is parallel to the acetabular margin, and the other incision will be just over the axis of the femoral neck. So you make a T-shaped incision like this. You open the capsule, see for the hindrance which is present, which is the ligamentum teres. It is ligamentum teres. When it is identified, put a right angle to hook the artery forceps. Just trace the ligamentum teres up to its base, so that you can identify the true acetabulum where it is, rather than reducing it into the false acetabulum. So once the true acetabulum is identified at the base of the ligamentum teres, you can just cut it with a scissor, excise the ligamentum teres. Also, you can have a scoop to remove the depth of the acetabulum. There will be pulvinar pad of fat which can be scooped out, and to have a wide visualization of the acetabulum, even the hip can be flexed and externally rotated, so that still the depth of the acetabulum can be easily visualized. So once this is done, the obstructing barriers, once they are removed, then we are attempting to reduce the hip. And meanwhile, at this point of time, when you visualize the acetabulum, the surgeon inspects the following points in the anterior approach, which is the depth of the acetabulum is inspected. He is checking the inclination of the acetabulum, how it is, whether it is lateral inclination is whether it is a shallow acetabulum, or it is a whether the acetabulum coverage is adequate. Then he is visualizing the shape of the femoral head, whether there is any cartilage damage to the femoral head, whether the medial aspect of femoral head is blunted. The condition of articular cartilage both on the femoral head side as well as the acetabulum side is checked, and degree of antiversion of femoral neck, that is also checked, and then the hip is reduced. The stability of hip is stability of reduction of hip is also then checked. So once the hip is reduced, it is stable, then capsulorraphy procedure is done. The capsulorraphy is, as we see here, there will be 3 leaves of capsule. This superolateral part of the capsule is it is sutured to the medial aspect here to ensure the stable maintenance of head within the acetabulum, and followed by that, we have the inferior triangular part of the capsule, which is opposed second, and finally the medial aspect, the one which is present over the acetabular region, that is closed. So that is how we close the capsule. Capsuloplasty or raphy is done. This closure is called as west over pans closure. This is how the capsule is repaired. If there is, during the reduction, if still the capsule is found lacks, the redundant capsule is excised, and then it is repaired. So after reduction, an AP radiograph is taken to check whether the femoral head abuts the triradiate cartilage. Below knee on the affected side and above knee on the normal side, with a bar in between the leg, a spica cast is applied. Single section CT or a perfusion MRI, like the medial approach. Here also we are checking for this stability of the hip, whether it is present within the acetabulum, femoral head within the acetabulum. And the perfusion MRI for the vascularity is checked. After 6 weeks, the cast is removed, examined and anesthesia. A second cast, but here the spica cast is not being applied. apart from spica cast, a petri cast is applied in child approached with an anterior approach. Petri cast is nothing but it is a long leg plaster which is placed in between the bars, kept in abduction. Why is this? Because in petri cast, the hip is kept free where you have adequate flexion and extension happening. So after 6 weeks following the first cast, the second cast when it is applied and following the second cast, you go for a petri cast in anterior approach. Sir, any doubts, sir?
Hello.
Sir, sorry, sir.
This is regarding medial approach. So medial approach through audible?
கேக்குதுங்க, you are audible. நீங்க நீங்க you are audible to everybody, no problem.
Okay, okay. Regarding the medial approach, the medial approach can be done till the age of 1.5 years. So another advantage of medial approach is now we can treat the bilateral dislocation at the same time because no need to change the position. In the same anesthesia, we can approach on the same side. You can do the reduction on the both sides. Bilateral approach. One problem is avascular necrosis because the medial circumflex vessels comes directly over the medial aspect. You have to be very, very careful. You have to dissect, undermine the vessels, and you have to cut the capsule under the vessel. So likely we are going to stretch the vessels. The AVN rate is very high, probably 40-50%. Nearly 30-40% avascular necrosis. So you have to be very, very careful when you are doing a medial approach. So medial approach can be done as early as at the age of 6 months also. Medial approach is more commonly used in irreducible teratological hips like arthrokyphosis, multiplus congenita, all this teratological dislocation. So we can do the medial approach at the age of 6 months, bilateral at the same time. As late as 1.5 years in a non-teratological hips, we can do it up to the age of 18 months. So the anterior approach is a gold standard. So anterior approach is a gold standard because we can do, as you mentioned, we can do the capsulorraphy and other things, everything. And again, open reduction, you told that we don't put a spica more than 6 weeks. So after 6 weeks, we remove the spica, we allow the child to move in the bed for 1 month. After 12 weeks, we allow the child to weight bear and walk. Then we give a nighttime bracing, abduction bracing, for at least for 6 months. That is a protocol we follow in the ICH.
Okay, sir.
Yeah.
This protocol was given in TACGEN, sir. Just adapted from TACGEN, sir. That's all.
No problem. Yes, sir. Different this thing, they follow the different
practicality. After 6 weeks, we can start.
Yeah.
We can remove the cast.
We normally put for 6 weeks, then we allow mobilization in bed. We instruct the mothers not to allow the child to weight bear. Always carry the child in the lap. Don't carry in the adducted position. Another 6 weeks, we allow the child to weight bear. Then we give a post-op, nighttime bracing, abduction bracing for at least 6 months.
So, Suresh, on the anterior approach, like, you don't take the vertical component of Smith-Peterson, no, or only you go only horizontal?
Only in the beginning incision.
Only in the beginning incision. Yeah, so, there is no necessity of the vertical component of Smith-Peterson?
No need.
Okay. And how about the injury to lateral cutaneous nerve of thigh? So, how often it gets injured? So, how we do it? Do we have to really worry about that?
No need to worry. Till we go into the plane, so we will be very careful in protecting the nerves.
Okay.
After that, we often forget the nerve. We concentrate more in the capsular dissection, capsulorraphy. But end of the closure, we use the search, where is the nerve? Sometimes we found the nerve is cut.
Okay.
If it is a situation, then you pull the nerve and cut it near the inguinal ligament in a sharp cut. Just leave it. The nerve end will retract into the abdomen, peritoneum.
Okay.
So that most of the children, they don't complain even in the childhood, I have seen many children. No children complained about the paresthesia or anything. No. Yes.
And two things I wanted to ask that. So what about the femoral nerve recovery? So suppose you find out that the femoral nerve is getting
injured
in a pavlicanus. So how significant is the femoral nerve problem and whether it'll recover? So
it'll recover definitely. You have to reduce the flexion. If you recognize it, you reduce the flexion, that's all.
Okay.
Suppose we're putting in a 120 degree, then you reduce it to 100 degree.
Okay.
Pavlik so, runners enough. This is only the compression neuropathy. It's only neuropraxia.
Yeah, that is only
it'll recover.
That should recover. Okay.
Yes,
okay.
Yes.
Sir, shall I continue, sir?
Ah, sure, sure.
Yes, sir. So, from the age group of 2 to 8 years, just a minute. So, in the age group of 2 to 8 years, definitely a traction will be required for...
Manoj, at this point, I wanted to mention, regarding the traction now, we are not using traction. Nobody is using traction nowadays. There is no... role for preoperative traction.
Okay, sir.
It is only controversy, but most of the surgeons, even in India and abroad, they are not using traction. Only a few are using traction. So the traction is not important. So we can straight away go and release the soft tissue contractors. If the reduction is tight, you do a shortening of the femur. That is recommended.
Okay, sir. So as I said, the reduction definitely will be tight in the age group of 2 to 8 years of age. As a child is of older age, there will be a tight reduction. So we would have to do a femoral shortening procedure for those patients to reduce the pressure over the hip. So most of the children will go for an open reduction in the age group of 2 to 8 years. Also, if required, acetabular reorienting osteotomy, pelvic osteotomy may be required to have a coverage of the femoral head.
Suresh, am I audible?
Yes.
One more doubt. After the open reduction procedure is complete,
yes.
Is it routine to fix the reduction with K-wire, thick K-wire or... cast is enough.
No need. No. If you do the capsulorraphy nicely, there is no need for wire.
Can we use the K wire? Thick K wire. Can we use it?
No. The problem is the K wire. Sometimes it breaks. No. If you have a doubt, then you can put the K wire in a. So whatever way. Suppose you have to put the K wire with the hip in 30 degree of flexion, 30 degree of abduction, then probably. 10 to 15 degree of neutral rotation, you hold it and use the K-wire, then you repair everything. Then when you are transferring the child to the spike guard table, again, you have to be very careful. Sometimes, no, the wire breaks.
Same thing happened actually in Coimbatore.
Okay.
I think you remember Vivekananda.
Yes. He told me, yes. He retrieved, I think.
Yeah, what happened was, we actually fixed it with K-wire.
Okay.
And after 2 weeks, I think check X-ray was taken. Initial X-ray was okay, perfect. The patient child was on his spike guard, but after 2 weeks, the X-ray repeated showed that the K-wire is broken.
My advice is no. If you are in doubt, use the K-wire. Once the spike guard is set, you pull the K-wire. You keep the K-wire outside the plaster.
Okay.
You put a long K-wire. You maintain the K-wire till the spike guard sets. Once the spike sets, you pull up the K-wire because after that, the K-wire has got no role.
Yes.
Better to...
Then what we did was, we removed the K-wire in the acetabulum side through a laparoscopic procedure.
Yeah, he told me. That's a very deadly complication. Sometimes the wire will migrate into the bladder and there's a lot of this thing. So, better thing is you take off the K-wire. If you are in doubt, you take off the K-wire immediately when the spike has set. Before shifting the child from the theater, you take off the K-wire. Don't keep the K-wire after the once the spike is set.
Okay. Thank you.
So shall I continue, sir?
Yes, sir.
So one potential complication which has been observed in this age group is after doing a femoral shortening procedure is combined with an osteotomy will be a posterior dislocation of hip. This occurs because there after doing a femoral shortening procedure, there is a slight increase in femoral antiversion because a derotation happens. And this posterior dislocation can be avoided by avoiding the femoral derotation which is occurring during the femoral shortening. So this is the femoral shortening. If excessive pressure is placed on the femoral head after reduction, we definitely require a femoral shortening. This is assessed by distracting the femoral head out of the acetabulum. The surgeon should distract the femoral head out of the acetabulum. He should check. The distraction should be only a few millimeters and it should be without much force. So he should be able to distract it without much force. If there is much force required for distracting, then definitely a femoral shortening should be done for such child. Usually done more than 2 years old child or 18 months to 2 years old child. It requires a separate lateral incision, either an intertrochanteric osteotomy or a subtrochanteric osteotomy is done with a simple lateral plate being fixed to the for the stability of the femur. And regarding the pelvic osteotomies, it is done more than 18 months age old age group. A surgeon checks first the degree of the acetabular coverage of the femoral head by placing the hip in extension, neutral rotation and abduction position. Simply we can say he takes a von Drosen view where he can check the where the line which passes through the femoral shaft, whether it cuts the acetabulum or it is going outside the acetabulum, we can check. Or in that view itself, we can check whether the epiphysis is within the acetabulum, adequate coverage is there or not, we can check. And based on that, we can plan whether the patient will need a redirecting or a restructuring osteotomy to be done in a 2 to 8 years old child. So based on that, if the head is not having an adequate coverage, frequently innominate osteotomies such as Salter osteotomy and Pemberton osteotomy is preferred in 2 to 8 year old group. And this osteotomy usually is done high enough to avoid injury to the cartilaginous margin. As I said yesterday, any injury to the periacetabular area where there will be where the epiphyseal cartilage is present over the periacetabular area in the shape of a hemisphere, if any injury occurs there, there will be definitely growth disturbance of the cartilaginous acetabulum. Hence, the osteotomy should be done high enough to avoid injury to the cartilaginous margin. So this is just a brief of what I told till now regarding the treatment. In neonate, pelvic harness, preferred method of treatment. In 1 to 6 months of age, still pelvic harness gives a better result. More than 6 months, till 18 months, as I told, if traction is not necessary, straight away go for a closed reduction, trial of closed reduction. If it is successful, it is okay. If it's not successful, go for an open reduction. So the age group less than 1 year, go for a medial approach. More than 1 year, go for an anterolateral approach. From 18 to 24 months, just a trial of closed reduction can be attempted. If it is not possible, just straight away go for a primary open reduction with or without a pelvic osteotomy for the acetabular coverage. From 2 years to 8 years, definitely it is the primary open reduction through the anterolateral approach. If required, femoral shortening should be done. Also, a pelvic osteotomy to be done. The complications of DDH are for the four things, which is avascular necrosis of femoral head, which occurs due to the treatment we do, mainly the wide abduction and internal rotation. As Sir told, the internal rotation, it torts the capsule, compressing the medial circumflex femoral artery, thus causing AVN. So it is better. The thing is that during treatment, we should be very careful not to induce AVN to the child, which is very crippling for the developing child. The second one is the inadequate reduction and redislocation. Third is the residual acetabular dysplasia, which is still which will be persistent. And acetabular dysplasias, which are presenting in the late adolescent age groups. So if it is an inadequate reduction or a redislocation, which is the most common complication, we have to take a single section CT to confirm it whether there is a reduction is adequate or not. If it is inadequate, you can attempt for a second close reduction under anesthesia. Even if the second close reduction fails, then it is better to go for an open reduction. Open reduction and reduce it and place it in a cast. The most difficult situation occurs when if the hip is not reduced even after the open reduction. Once the open reduction is done and it is, the child is placed in a cast and single section CT is taken, Still, if the femoral lid is not having a concentric reduction with the acetabulum, then that is a difficult situation where, again, if you open, it will be the anatomy will be disturbed, and that time you need to definitely have an experienced surgeon by your side to repeat the open reduction. The other thing is the residual acetabular. Third one is the residual acetabular dysplasia. So after reduction, we know that the femoral lid is within the acetabulum. The acetabulum gradually remodels due to the pressure exerted by the femoral lid, and the acetabulum development occurs. Gradual deepening of the acetabulum will occur. The obliquity will get reduced. If this process is incomplete, even though the femoral lid is within the acetabulum, but the acetabulum remains shallow with an inclined roof, then there is a residual acetabular dysplasia which will require a pelvic osteotomy. So for this, we have to see a reliable indicator is there, which is nothing but development of sore sill, which is called as an eyebrow for the acetabulum. Development of sore sill, it is a reliable indicator for the acetabular development. It indicates a true coverage of femoral head. The position of sore sill has to be seen. That will give an idea about the true coverage of the femoral head. And this is the sore sill. As you can see, the first image, the sore sill is very much adequate, the eyebrow of the acetabulum. The extent of area is more, so that the pressure over the hip joint is less. As you can see, a maximum of 18 kilopascals per centimeter square. So the second diagram, the sore sill, the extent of the area is getting reduced and the load over that area is getting increased. And subsequently, you can see the fourth diagram, it's very much reduced, where you have an enormous load being carried over the hip joint. So, if the acetabular obliquity is persisting even after the age of 5 years, after being reduced, still the acetabular inclination is increased or obliquity is still present. After 5 years, the development of acetabulum is very minimal. So, we need to plan for a pelvic osteotomy. So, acetabular dysplasias presenting late. This is one situation. It is usually in adolescent age group. There may be a history of treatment for hip dislocation. So the patient usually presents with a pain in the groin or a lateral hip pain, mainly due to the abductor weakness. Pain usually worsens on exertion during walking, standing, decreases with activity. He will have a limp definitely. Trendelenburg sign may be present. The sign of snapping or popping, it will be a sign which is elicited by the surgeon. These patients in the adolescent age group, they may present with a tear in the labrum. This tear occurs because of degeneration of the labrum in this age group. And to confirm it, we can do an impingement test where we can provocate the pain by excessively flexing, internally rotating and adducting the hip so that the pain gets exacerbated. Also, we can confirm the labral pathology by doing a gadolinium enhanced MRI scan. In these patients, when you take a standard AP view, when you take a von Rosen view, we can determine the reduction of hip. We can determine the concentric reduction of hip. As already mentioned about von Rosen view, it is an abduction internal rotation view with hip in extension. The femoral metaphysis will be facing the acetabulum. You need to draw a line from the shaft. It cuts through the acetabulum. If it cuts through the acetabulum, it is concentrically reduced. If the line goes beyond the acetabulum, then the reduction is not adequate. So a von Rosen view will be taken. Also, a false profile view also is necessary in this age group to see the ventral central edge angle. As mentioned yesterday, it should be around more than 25 degree. If it is less than that, then the anterior acetabular coverage is being compromised. So the patient will require an acetabulum redirecting procedure. Also in this view, we can see the width of the posterior column of the acetabulum, which is essential for planning the osteotomy. Also in an AP radiograph, if you take, we can see whether the acetabulum is dysplastic by checking the concavity of the acetabular roof, whether there is an excessive lateral inclination, how the teardrop is present, if there is a widening of the teardrop. Then subluxation also can be seen as the distance between the femoral end and the medial wall of acetabulum is increased. All these things were discussed earlier yesterday. The extra thing which is seen in this age group is, as I said before, the double degeneration of the labrum. So there may generation seen in the AP view in the acetabulum site. You can see the presence of sclerosis or the cyst formation, narrowing of the joint space, as well as the osteophyte formation. So what we do if the dysplasia, which is coming late in the adolescent age group, treatment is, this is more than TS we are discussing. The treatment will be when the hip is concentrically reduced after taking an abduction internal rotation view to check the femoral head is well reduced within the acetabulum. We are checking that if it is concentrically reduced, then a redirectional procedure can be done to just accommodate the femoral head. If the abduction internal rotation view, when we are taking and we are checking if the femoral head is not getting reduced within the acetabulum, so the concentric reduction is not there, then we need to go for a salvage procedure. Salvage procedure will be the Chiari's procedure or the Staheli's procedure. Intermediate cases where we take an abduction internal rotation view, the femoral head is not within the acetabulum, then what we need to do is we need to go for an open reduction. We need to reduce the femoral head, or we need to go for a femoral redirectional procedure, reduce the femoral head. Then we need to do a redirectional acetabular procedure. So in case of asymptomatic dysplastic children, whether the treatment is essential or not, yes, definitely we need to treat these children to prevent future degenerative disease. Just we need to reposition the femoral head within the acetabulum and restore the normal acetabular alignment. So this is a brief view of the acetabulum presenting late, what we need to do. Dysplasia presenting late, what we need to do. If there is a concentric reduction in the age group of 2 to 8 years, we can go for a Salter's osteotomy or a Pemberton osteotomy. Salter's osteotomy, it redirects the acetabulum. Pemberton osteotomy, it restructures the acetabulum but decreases the volume of the acetabulum. In 8 to 15 years of age group, where the triradiate cartilage is open, we can go for a triple innominate osteotomy of Steele or double innominate osteotomy of Sutherland. Both redirecting procedure. In more than 15 years, where the triradiate is closed, Gans procedure will be a better procedure, where you have a maximal acetabular redirection. It achieves a stable pelvis, but this procedure is a bit difficult. The other procedure is the spherical procedure, which is described by Wagner and Epiright, where also we can get a maximal acetabular redirection. So these are procedures which are done when there is a concentric reduction obtained. If a concentric reduction is not obtained, so without a concentric reduction, we need to go for a shelf procedure or a Chiari procedure, which are salvage procedures done in the acetabulum. So finally, a word about teratological dislocation of hip, or it is called as antenatal dislocation of hip. The hip dislocated before birth is called as teratologic dislocation of hip. It has limited range of movements. It will not be reducible on examination. It is associated with the meningomyelocele, arthrogryposis, lumbosacral agenesis. These are the neuromuscular disorders that will be associated. So what the surgeon should consider is the functional level of the patient has to be determined, so that the ambulation prognosis for the ambulation will be determined. Usually for arthrogryposis patients, though the movements are restricted, adequate movements will be available. Adequate flexion, extension, rotation and abduction will be available. So in these patients where there is some motor ability in the lower extremity and reasonable trunk control, we can go for an open reduction. In the text, it is given as anterolateral approach. Anteromedial approach. Okay. So the medial approach, as sir said, open reduction by medial approach at 6 months of age, we can do for a teratological dislocation case occurring due to arthrogryposis. For older children, if femoral shortening is required, we can do to avoid excessive pressure over the acetabulum. In case of meningomyelocele, since the paralytic levels will be high, it is better to leave the patient untreated rather than going for an open reduction. That's all, sir. And this will be a question for the PGs regarding this session. Sir, am I audible, sir?
Yes.
Sir?
Well, you are very much audible. No problem. Before, you have many questions?
Only one question, sir. Only one question.
Okay. Mudichiruma, no problem.
Okay, sir. Cholan. What is the early radiographic sign in successful treatment in 1 to 6 months age group will be a notch above the acetabulum. I showed the image. Okay. That is the notch above the acetabulum. That indicates ossification beneath the labrum is occurred.
Yes, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Suresh Babu, you want to add anything?
The practical, some of the points, never diagnose a painful dislocated hip as a DDH. That's for the PGs. So when you are seeing a dislocation in a hip which is painful, always suspect it is a postseptic dislocation. It's a very common postseptic dislocation. You will have a same ortholonis test positive, bolus test positive, but it will be painful. Child cries. Child will not move. Mother will tell the child is not moving. Sometimes they will examine even PGs. Sometimes they will ask the PGs what to examine the child, what is the diagnosis. They will examine, they will find that it is a ortholonic test positive. They will say it is a DDH. So DDH is never painful. One point I want to mention. Second thing is, don't do CT scan or MR scan to diagnose the DDH. Don't take a CT scan and MR scan to diagnose the DDH. Ultrasound is more than enough. Like I have seen some of the patients coming to the clinic at 3 months of age with the MRI, CT scan, everything in the hand.
Okay.
So too much of investigation, too much of radiation for the child.
Yes.
That is another.
Especially the...
Yes. Then again, don't rely more on the ultrasound to diagnose the DDH. Because ultrasound is operator dependent. Many times there is a false positive as well as false negative reports are there. If the sonologist is very much trained in doing a pediatric ultrasound, then probably you can rely. So otherwise, clinical examination, very good clinical examination in a calm child with a good environment is the best investigation, best clinical tool to diagnose. Any doubts, PGs can ask.
I have a doubt, sir.
Yes.
Sir, the safe zone of Ramsey is the importance.
No. He has mentioned about the mild, moderate and the zones, but in practically it's very difficult to exactly find out what is safe and what is unsafe zone on table. So,
yes,
practically, no. If a reduction requires more than 60 degrees of abduction,
okay,
it is very unsafe. More than 60 degree. More abduction is unsafe. More internal rotation. If it is stable in more internal rotation, that is unsafe.
Okay. Sir.
Then
okay.
If the hip dislocates, from the abduction, you are bringing the child to slowly reduce abduction. 45, 50, 30 degree. If the dislocates around less than 40 degree, then it's probably unstable.
Okay.
You understand now? The hip is reduces in abduction. Then you gradually decrease the abduction. And if dislocates at 40 degree, less than 40 degree, if it is 45 degree, it's 40 degree. If it dislocates, the probability is unstable.
Okay.
Then it is called unstable dislocation. Again, you can increase a safe zone by doing adductor tenotomy.
Okay.
I think, Manoj, you mentioned about adductor tenotomy.
Illa sir, adha na mention pannala.
After arthrogram, you reduce it and check the safe zone. If the safe zone is narrow, if it dislocates, you do adduct sternotomy, whether percutaneous sternotomy or if you are not comfortable in percutaneous sternotomy, you put a small incision, identify the adductor tendon and release it. No point, no problem. You can do a small incision, also release it. Then you check the zone again. You find that there is more stability. Now, hip is not dislocating in a less than 40 degree of adduction. It is very stable. Then you put it in a spica. Again, when you are changing the spica in 6 weeks, you told, no, after taking out from this thing, if it is unstable, you don't decide for open reduction. You put it in a reduced, check the safe zone. You have a doubt, you do again arthrogram. Make sure the hip head is constantly reduces. You put the spica again. So you can do again a close reduction, then put it in a proper position and a spica. Then you can try the spica for another 6 weeks.
Okay, sir.
So you decide at the time of close reduction, it is unstable. It requires more wide abduction, more internal rotation. Then you're going to go for an open reduction. So always consent from the parents, close reduction as well as for the open reduction. Yes.
Sir, how often we do arteriography for assessing AVN after procedures?
No, arteriography, yeah?
To check AVN, sir. How often
do we do investigation, sir? No, zero. We don't
X-ray
do.
X-ray is enough. X-ray is enough. X-ray is enough.
X-ray is enough.
Yeah, but the X-ray after...
Yeah, you can... The thing is, no, you have to follow the principles. So what are the things you should avoid to prevent the AVN? So don't abduct too much. Don't internally rotate too much. Put a proper spica. Then if you are in doubt, you can do a perfusion MRI.
Okay, sir.
We don't do this top-secret investigations.
Okay, sir.
Suresh, there is one question.
Yes.
How do the parents cooperate? Because we are put initially on pollex harness and then on some children need this pica. So how the parents cooperate with this treatment schedule?
A lot of counseling with the parents regarding the pica. You have to show some clinical pictures and you have to educate the parents. Because the very important is spica care. Many times, you know, you put a spica, within a week, they will come with a completely soaked with motion and urine. That is a problem. Then you have to change the spica again. So very, very important, you know, you have to educate the parents. Again, after the spica, we have to cover the edges with a proper, we normally use the butter paper. You know, the butter paper, which is available in the hotels, you use a butter paper and insert the butter, one edge of the butter paper between the POP and the skin, and fold it outside and strap it with a micropore. So that even the urine or motion sometimes accidentally soaks, no, it will be over the butter paper only. You can take up the butter paper and replace the butter paper.
As in children with the CTEV, the size of the cast is also less. Because it extends only up to the above knee level.
Above knee, yes.
And every time we are moving the cast, the parents are also seeing what is happening to the deformity. So the deformity is slowly correcting. They are happy and they are, as you said, they are more motivated to maintain the POP because the POP is kind of doing the job. But in these cases, their parents are not able to see anything, obviously, and what is happening to the child's sleep and other things. And they are too much worried and only depend on the doctor's advice and other whatever he says.
You can show the pre-op X-ray and the post-op X-ray CT scan. That is the only way.
You can share our knowledge.
Yes. Or we can show the example. For example, if you are treated, if you have some other examples, previous patient dislocated and you had followed the child, you can show the X-rays. So always you show the X-rays and show the sum of the spica of the child. So then you can be able to educate the children and... Very, very, it's a valid question because some of the children are coming far away from the village. No, they don't have a AC, air condition, because there's a lot of sweating will be there within the spica. So the taking care of the plaster without soaking with the urine motion is a very big problem. Especially in our setup, patient coming from the poor socioeconomic group, it's very, very difficult. So maybe in those children, we have to see the child once in 3 weeks, make sure that everything is good. The spica is not broken. Sometimes it came with a broken spica, everything dislocates. That is why, you know, the wire is very, very, the you put the wire, sometimes the child will broke the POP. So the wire will also broke.
The wire also is broken.
Yeah. So if you are in doubt, you put a waterproof plaster over that. Put a waterproof plaster and reinforce, and frequently see the child. Once in 2 weeks, make sure that everything is normal.
Okay. Sir, understood.
Sir, your experience with Gore-Tex, sir. You have used Gore-Tex, sir.
What is it?
it has been given in Taxan that to avoid skin irritation, Gore-Tex is being applied first before applying the Spica, sir. So that's what I wanted to ask.
No, I have not used it.
Okay, sir.
Maybe we don't know what it is even. I don't know. Maybe soft and soft roll, but I think they're using something.
Okay.
Which will not irritate the skin, I think. That is, it should be only that.